Hey everybody, I'm Brandon72Mo. This is the Dubachi Exemplar, and I'm about to find out if it'll off-road. This is the second most voted for vehicle this week, coming in with 10 votes, and you can vote for the vehicles that you want to see by clicking on the link in the description down below. So we're going to take the Exemplar up to the start line, and as we do that, I want to let you know that something that at least a couple of you have requested should be live by time this video is up. That's right, I have a spreadsheet now that will show you the times from everything that I have tested in Will It Off-Road. It'll have their ascent, descent, and damage descent times, as well as notes about the damage and any other notes, like if it was raining or anything like that. There will be a separate tab for Will It Off-Road in the snow. And you'll also be able to see the current voting for all of the Will It Off-Road. It should be updated. Like, if somebody goes and votes, it should be updated right away if it's a car that's been voted for before. If not, it'll be something that I'll have to manually add in. But it'll pull dynamically from the spreadsheet that I use to track the voting into the spreadsheet that you'll be able to view. So the voting should be up to date. So if you're looking to spam out votes and you know exactly how many times you have to click to submit the vote to get a vehicle all the way to the top of the list, you'll be able to click that or check that spreadsheet and find out exactly where each vehicle stands. So the Exemplar, this is actually a car that I have a lot of time in. Back in my Xbox 360 days when I spent a lot of time racing, whenever coupes was the class, the Exemplar was usually the car that you would find me in. I know that the Zion has better acceleration, and it has a little bit better cornering. I just prefer the driving style of the Exemplar, and I can kick some pretty serious ass against an average racer with the Exemplar. A lot of people call it the four-door elegy because they have very similar handling characteristics, and it's true, they really do. Even though this is not an all-wheel drive car, at least I don't believe it is, I'm pretty sure it's just rear-wheel drive, it does handle a lot like the regular elegy RH8. So if you're good in that car as a race car, then when it comes to coupes, you should be able to turn in pretty good lap times in the Exemplar as well. Don't really foresee too many problems with the Exemplar. Most of the issues that are going to be had in this run are going to be because I was pushing it maybe a little too hard. We've got one coming up here, right there. Didn't correct my steering quite enough, almost drove off the side. But that's one of the things I love about the Exemplar. It's got a lot of grip, despite the fact it does not have a spoiler. And even when it starts sliding, it's really easy to get this thing back under control. So not a big deal that it started to slide off the side, because I was able to just squeeze the gas a little bit, steer back to the right, and got us right back on the path. And of course, this thing's just breezing right up this mountain. Gonna turn in a really good time. Usually right around 3 minutes is a really good time. Anything above that is kind of slow. Anything below that's exceptionally fast. So 3 minutes seems to be what's a good time for Will It Off-Road. And of course, this one is up in 3 minutes, 2 seconds. So will the Exemplar off-road? Yes, beautifully, I might add. Does very, very well over the bumpy stuff. Does great in the dirt. But that means we now have to take it back down Mount Chiliad for our controlled descent. Beginning now. And again, I don't really foresee any problems with this. Plenty of grip, good brakes. I misjudged my my angle there and kind of went off the edge. Again, not the car's fault, just me. Bad driver. Being very careful to come down off the side, and then we can get on the gas a little bit and get some speed to go down the trail. By the way, I do want to address something that I've noticed to be a trend on my Will It Off-Road videos. Shortly after each one goes live, whether it's the regular Will It Off-Road or Will It Off-Road in the snow, there's somebody who always clicks the dislike button. And that's fine. If you don't like the Will It Off-Road videos, you're welcome to click dislike. But I've just got two things to say about it. One, if you're trying to show your displeasure about the series, that you just don't like the series, you need to leave me some feedback. I love constructive criticism. Of course, you know, you suck, or you're gay, or that car is ugly. All of these things could possibly be true. It doesn't help me, those type of comments. let me know why you're clicking dislike. You know, do you just not like the series? It's, you know, not a good use of time. What? And secondly, if you're just trying to, like, hurt the video in some way by clicking dislike, well, mission failed. Because YouTube counts likes and dislikes pretty much the same. They're just audience engagement. If you click like or dislike, you are more likely to see that content creator's videos in your recommended feed, even if you click dislike, because you engaged with that video. Same thing with leaving comments. It's all audience engagement. That's why me and nearly every other YouTuber out there tends to remind people to add, you know, hey, click like, leave a comment, let me know what you think. It helps our videos get promoted. So if you're trying to hurt my Will It All for Road videos, you failed. Because that dislike counts as audience engagement, and you're actually boosting the chances that my Will It Off-Road videos will be recommended. So, thank you. But please, seriously, if there's something about the videos you don't like, let me know about it. I love feedback from my viewers. I'm constantly working to bring you the stuff you want to see, as well as the stuff that I enjoy making. So, good or bad, let me hear what you think in the comments down below. The Exemplar is handling all of this beautiful, all the jumps, all the bumps, all the uneven terrain, and the dirt is just not a problem for this Exemplar. We're back down on the pavement where this thing really shines. I love driving this car. It's one that I often forget that I own, but every time I get in it, I'm very happy to see it handles fantastic. And we're down in 2 minutes 53 seconds, which means taking it back to the top of Mount Chiliad for our damage descent as night begins to fall in GTA Online. And here we go. This car actually does have some pretty good damage rendering models in it, so we should actually see some denting and things like that that we don't often see in some of the newer vehicles that have been added to the game, because Rockstar developers have gotten too lazy to do that. I can't think of any other reason why they don't do it. All the other cars that were added before DLCs have pretty realistic damage models, so why don't the new ones? There's no reason for it other than they're just being lazy and taking shortcuts. The Exemplar seems to want to spend most of its time upside down. I guess it's a top-heavy car, because every time I get it on its wheels, something will upset it and send it right back on its roof again. Getting a little bit of a good run here on the wheels, but that's probably not going to last. Or maybe it will. Oh, almost flipped over. No, it's up. Oh, there it goes. It rolled, finally. Surprised, as much as the doors and the hood keep coming open, that we haven't lost any of them yet. It is taking quite a beating, though, but the engine, no rattling, so that's a big plus. It does help that there's 100% armor, but as we've seen in a lot of these World Off-Road videos, even 100% armor can't always protect the engine from damage. Exemplar is struggling a little bit here in the mud to find traction and keep going in a straight line. But a lot of even off-road type vehicles do struggle here, so nothing too out of the ordinary. But we're coming up around the big log pile. Then we are down on the damage descent in 1 minute 42 seconds. Let's take a look at the damage. We've got most of the lights gone. All the windows are missing. The doors are misaligned. There is very significant body denting. Check out the front end here in just a second. And the wheels are bent. I mean, look at this front end. That's just sad. Anyways, that brings us to our next vehicle. The Scorcher, which strangely doesn't have a manufacturer name in the game. I don't know. This is the first most voted for vehicle this week with 16 votes. And of course, you can always vote for the vehicles that you want to see by clicking on the link in the description down below, if I remembered to include it. Hi, Rocket. Rocket makes his appearance in frame. Ringing the bell since I can't rev the engine, and we're off. We're going to take out an old hiker. On a bicycle, no less. So I thought it was really funny after last week's little off-road. Dexira, I know I'm saying it wrong, bro. I'm sorry. I never will learn that one. I don't know why. Who voted for the two bicycles, actually said he thought I would ignore them. But no, if somebody's going to take the time to to vote for a vehicle. As long as it's something that can be tested, I'll do it. I'm game. It was a lot of fun to do the bicycles. I kind of enjoyed the serenity of it all. No engine sounds, no tires screeching. Just me and nature and a bicycle. It's kind of the reason I own a bicycle in real life. Just to kind of, you know, escape and get to see a little bit of nature. So, kind of enjoyed doing the bikes, actually. Though my thumb did get quite a workout from smashing the A button. But it has recovered as I recorded these a few weeks ago. My thumb's much better. Though it has quite the six-pack now. That's right, my thumb has a six-pack. If you believe that. But anyways, the bicycles all do really well. This one actually looks like it's suited for the terrain. Because it's a hardtail type hybrid. Mountain bike slash street bike. So it looks like it's more suited. So I'd be able to do this. Can we get another hiker? Oh, got close. She called me a ball scratcher. Well, I'm a dude. And dudes scratch the balls, so accuracy to that one. But, yeah, the bicycles all do fine. It's just a matter of smashing the A button. If you don't hit the button to keep accelerating, you won't go up the hill at all on some of these hills. Because you just can't hold A down. And that's the same as holding the right trigger down in the car. And it will cause you to pedal some. But you don't get enough speed on bicycles to actually make it up the mountain. In some of these steeper parts, you'll just stop. So you do have to keep smashing A. But it's fine. Because I don't mind testing the vehicles. I mean, we've tested boats. We've tested 18-wheelers. Next week, you're going to see the prison bus. Which I will also be featuring in next week's World Off-Road in the snow. So it'll be a prison bus special. And by the way, I know that I didn't have a World Off-Road in the snow video this week. There was some issues to be had, or that were had, that prevented me from getting that done in time. And instead of releasing it a day late, or on a different day, or whatever, I just decided we'd skip it this week. And we'll pick up Will It Off-Road in the Snow again next week on Tuesday. Of course, on Tuesday, I also hope to have a garage tour video up. Not 100% certain that's going to happen just yet. Garage tour videos are the video I make that has the most time that goes into their production. Each one, without exaggeration, takes about 15 to 17 hours of work. To record the vehicles, to edit the video, to do the voiceover. A lot of work goes into my garage tour videos. Will It Off-Road's actually gotten pretty simple. I've done so many of these that I have a lot of templates and things that I just drop into place. Literally, the longest part is chopping up the video. One guy called me an asshole. I don't know what the other one said. But I was just kind of chopping the video up is the most time-consuming part and getting the timers just right. After that, it's a piece of cake to put in the timers actual on the screen and all the titles, cards that you see and everything. It's all piece of cake. I have it all in templates. Even the timer position. And all that is one little template that I just drag and drop, and it's in. So the Will It Off-Road videos have gotten quite easy to make. They used to take a lot of time, but I've streamed like that. But the garage tour videos, oh my god, they take so much time. But I'm going to try to get one or two garage tour videos out next week, and then one or two the week after that. Maybe go into a third week. There's going to be four updates, because I have 48 brand new cars since last update. The Scorcher is up! 4 minutes, whatever. 19 seconds as I ran over the same hiker twice. You let the police handle it, buddy. Will It Off-Road? I got a little late on that, but yeah, it will. It's a good bike. All the bikes will off-road, though. That's been my experience. But it means going for the controlled descent, and that's where things can get a little more interesting on a bicycle. Simply because they do tend to get air quite easy because they're quite light.
Yeah, I hear you.
So while you want to get some speed, you also have to make sure you're not getting too much speed so that when you hit something, you don't go flying off the side of the mountain. If you keep that in mind, everything else is fine. You do have to be mindful of your braking because bicycles don't have the best brakes. So you got to be careful and really plan ahead. And on some of the bikes, they will lock up the front tire quicker than the rear tire, this one especially, which could cause the back end to want to come around on you. So you got to be careful of how hard you hit the brakes as well. Beyond those two considerations, you're free to just head down the mountain on a bicycle. And again, it's just kind of a nice, peaceful way to get up and down the mountain. I mean, look at the beautiful views. No sound of an engine, just the sound of the wheels through the dirt and the wind in the mountain. It's just, I love it. I had a lot of fun doing a bicycle. I really did. Not going to do them anymore anytime soon, unless I get voted for, of course, but definitely had a lot of fun with them. People, when I told them I was testing bicycles, though, the people I was playing with out there, they're like, you're doing what? Exactly? Why? Somebody voted for it. That's why. Not a lot to say, though, about a controlled descent on a bicycle. I mean, it goes over the jumps really well. As long as you make sure you pull back on the stick so that you don't nosedive, you're going to be fine. If you do nosedive, you're going to go flying over the handlebars. But other than that, it's really easy to get the bikes to go down back down the mountain. Somehow, Taco's managed to get a $7,000 bounty. But in the vainglorious, we let each other keep our bounties, because it's not about the money as it is the RP. Because if you survive your bounty, you get RP. And every little bit helps when you're ranking up. Not that I'm a low level or anything, but man, you take my bounty, I'm going to be mad because I didn't get my RP. I don't give a shit about the money. At most, it's 9 grand. I can make 9 grand in 5 minutes, but yeah, I want my RP, so leave my bounties alone. It is nice to play with a group of people that you don't have to worry about hunting you down just because you stole some dude's car and now you have a bounty. We're coming around to our final bit of dirt here. Still smashing that A button to keep the speed up. Of course, the bikes are really easy to control and really easy to get around a corner. God, you don't even get to hear the sawmill buzz very often because of the sounds of the cars coming through there. Kind of forgot that the sawmill even had all those ambient sounds going on. We're back down onto asphalt now. Coming around our last few final corners. And the Scorcher has done absolutely beautifully. Of course, that means potential suicide lurks just around the corner. So we are going to have to go back to the top in just a minute. But we're down in 3 minutes, 17 seconds. A beautiful descent for the Scorcher. But we're back at top of Mount Chiliad. Ringing the bell at sunset for our damaged descent. Cross your fingers. Let's see if I can survive this one. On bicycles and motorcycles, it's all about getting lucky on the landing. Trying to aim for something that you can kind of bounce off of with that rear tire and not get thrown off the bike. Or landing too hard and getting killed that way. So you can kind of see that I'm aiming for things I can bounce off of. And then I'm keeping that back wheel down so that when I do land, it's not too hard of an impact, but oh! When I was editing this the first time through, I saw that, I laughed my ass off, because that was one hell of a faceplant onto the side of a rock. Didn't kill me, though, so we persevere and plod on. Continuing our damage descent. The bikes themselves don't seem to take any damage. I've never noticed one to do it anyways. The riders, however, well, that's a different story. Could get really ugly here with the train, but you just go under it. And the blurriest thing is because somebody entered the crew lobby and started chatting, and, well, I didn't figure anybody really wanted to read the chat, so, yeah, welcome to a blurry box that quickly goes away. The mud is no problem for bicycles either. Slows them down a little bit, but doesn't cause them to spin out or bounce around like it does a lot of the cars. But we're down around the wood pile and finishing on a damage descent in 1 minute 40 seconds. Let's take a look at the damage. None to the bicycle, but Beacon here suffered a broken arm, a fractured collarbone, a dislocated hip, and several broken ribs. Hey, if you enjoyed this video, you know what to do. Hit that like button. Get subscribed if you haven't already. Be sure to leave me a comment down below. I'm Brendan72Mo, and I'll see you in the next video.